initiative called FICCI ILIA, which is Indian Language Internet Alliance. And one of the main objectives of this is to work towards creating a truly multilingual Indic internet. And that is for the convenience of everybody who's watching this and the others who are not able to utilize the power of digital as well as the internet. We understand that there are multiple steps to actually realize this potential. And as FICCI, we have been working across the ecosystem. So one of the major initiatives is that we are working on the area of UA, universal assistance, along with the support of ICANN. And we have been delivering various, I would say, webinars and the consultations as well as research with the support of all you members. So this is another initiative which we have come across, which we are going to have it today, the discussion on a very important subject, which is on email address internationalization. We all understand that there are many of you who might be knowing it, who is EAI, and there might be others who would be interested, because that is something which will let your businesses reach the masses, actually utilize the potential of digital revolution. We all know that we've heard a recent, I would say, a sensation of Baba Ka Dhaba, which happened. Just imagine if that is available in multilingual Indic internet, the power it can create across the nation. So going in line with our Honorable Prime Minister's dream and working in tandem and consultation with the ministry and the other stakeholders, we as FICCI ILIA are happy to proudly present this webinar, which is on the topic of EAI. I'm not going to talk much about the EAI because we have all the experts who would take care of it during the discussion. For you, we have this have specifically organized that apart from the theoretical sessions, there would be also the touch of the technical thing which could actually help you out implementing EAI. You are my colleagues are obviously looking into the questions which would be posted by you over the chat. Please feel to ask questions as much as you want. We'll try our best to cover as much as we can during the session. Otherwise, we'll be also happy to take it offline with our panelists and others. So with these words, I officially welcome you all. And I would like to welcome our set of panelists who have joined us with us today. So we have Dr. Ajay Deta, who is the co-chair for ICT and Digital Economy Committee, FICCI, and of course, the chairman for the Universal Acceptance Steering Group, ICANN. We have Mr. Samiran Gupta, who is head of India ICANN. Shri Anil Kumar Jain, the CEO of NICSI, Ministry of Electronics and IT Government of India, would be joining us soon. And then, of course, we have the technical experts who have been here and who would actually take us through with the details of EAI. So we have a UA ambassador, Mr. Harish Chaudhary, who has kindly agreed to share a presentation on EAI with us. And then we have Mr. Lal Chin Saini, the EAI expert, who will talk about the real-time implementation, who have done it in their company and how it has affected them. And definitely we'll run through with a different set of questions with you. So with these words, I would stop my comments here. And we all look forward to a great session today. So I now request Dr. Deta to kindly deliver his official welcome address. Over to you, Dr. Deta.
Thank you very much, Sarika ji. Thank you, FICCI, for bringing this very important topic alive for all of us. As you know, email address plays a very important role in our internet life. Whether we want a ticket or a bank statement or a school admission for children, we know we need email address everywhere. And of course, for transmitting the multimedia files, communicating with the people, we require email address as a core identity which is communicable. How about an email address for people who do not prefer to have an email ID in English or do not know English? Basically breaking the language barrier. Those who do not know English, how do they have their email addresses? That is where a concept of domain names came into picture, which could be in any language. That is called IDN, internationalized domain name. Of course, any email address requires a domain name. We all know that. Now, how do we bring that domain name live? That is the purpose which is being served by NICSI, NIXI in Government of India for India in 22 languages. Now, how do we get email addresses? So on email addresses, it is very important to have a domain name. As we all know, let us say My email address is data.in and ajay@data.in. Data.in is being provided by Government of India, NICSI as an organization. I register a domain name there and then I go and host an email ID somewhere. So we host ourselves for our email addresses. Same way, a email address which is non-English, that can be, that has to be hosted somewhere and you require a domain name. So you go to NICSI, get a domain name. So my Hindi email address is ajay@data.bharat in Hindi in a Devanagari script. So if you know how to type in your phone, you can actually send an email on that email address. The basic principle of EAI is to have a domain name and provide an email address, at least with one character in that email address, which is non-ASCII. At least one character. It could be in a mailbox name, which is before the @ sign, or the domain name, which is the domain name after the @ sign. This is the two parts of mailbox or the email address. This is what our technical experts are going to talk to you today. As Universe Acceptance Group, we promote that all the email addresses, irrespective of the script, language, or the length, they must be accepted equally in every application, in every mobile app, in every software application or a website, wherever an email address is required. If an English email address or an ASCII email address is accepted, then the EAI must be accepted as well and as good as the ASCII email address. There are five principles: accept, validate, process, store, and display. That is the part of universal acceptance. And these are the pillars in which we test every implementation. And when something passes, then the application becomes UA ready. Just to tell you, who supports EAI in the country or in the world? So you should be aware that Microsoft entire Office 365 infrastructure, and including the MS Outlook, latest MS Outlook, supports EAI. Apple, the mail client in the Apple iPhone or iPad, supports EAI. Google infrastructure, Gmail infrastructure, and Google Apps infrastructure supports EAI. So what I'm trying to say with these examples is that global leaders worldwide supporting EAI, which means that it is a very important issue to be dealt with, because that is not just a standard, because the new people who are going to come online are going to follow the language based email addresses. So if your software or a mobile app do not support it, then you will lose customers to the bigger players, the giants, and you will not be able to serve them well because they cannot subscribe to you. So it's very, very important that you follow the new standard of EAI. Ensure that your softwares, your websites, your email addresses are EAI ready. Universal Acceptance Steering Group promotes that very actively, takes care of that very actively, takes it to the masses. We promote the acceptance, the uses, the technology, and this lots of documents are available online on uasg.tech website, where you can get lots of information, and certainly you can build your applications with those documents help. Please also pay attention to Harish and Lalchand's presentation. They are going to take you through a real life experiences and technical knowledge about, so it will give you some tips so that you know that some of the problems and hurdles or the questions you may have right now will be solved. EAI is a very important pillar, very, very important pillar. So you have to see that your application, if you are a developer or a CIO or a CTO or a owner of a company, if you are not doing, then you are holding a bug in your application, and that bug is going to leave your customer away. You will not be able to serve them. It is very important that EAI is enabled in your setup, whether it is an email server, whether it is your software and applications, you follow them. With these notes, I am going to leave this most of the talk to technical people and other speakers, but this is the fundamental of it. Thank you very much, Sarika, for inviting me and setting the base and context here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Dhita. And I'm sure with your inspiring welcome address, we can the audience can realize that the next 500 million internet users will be the Indic internet users. And truly to capture that potential for the benefit of the businesses as well as to contribute in Digital India, EAI is one of the important pillars. So yes, now I would request another expert and the speaker, Mr. Samiran Gupta, who is the head of India ICANN, to deliver his opening remarks. We are really thankful to ICANN for supporting Vicky for the UA initiative and a local chapter which we are running in. And we feel it's a big journey which we all have to take together. So we need a lot of support from you, audience, in terms of your contribution and participation in these activities, as well as your feedback to help us improve and make us better for the future. So over to you, Mr. Gupta.
You are mute, Samiran.
You are mute, Mr. Gupta.
Thank you. Sorry about that. Excuse me. So thank you, Sarika ji. And Vicky for taking this initiative, and of course thank you Dr. Data for your introductory remarks. So I'm going to take just a couple of minutes to talk about what ICANN does, so that you know, those who joined and perhaps for the first time hearing the name ICANN would understand a little bit. So our role globally is to coordinate the unique identifiers of the internet. So that really means the domain name system, names, numbers, and protocol parameters. Now, this is where you know, we are, names and numbers. We are looking at a set of names which for the longest time was an ASCII. And now we are saying that why not have this in different scripts? So 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, many elements of this technology were still in the process of development. The first internationalized domain name was made available in 2009. But over the years, a lot of work has happened. And now, thanks to a lot of the support of the technical and linguistic community in India, we actually have the ability to support many Indian scripts, and if you would like to get an email ID in an Indian script, it is now possible. As Ajayji already mentioned, it's very clear that the next billion internet users will come from non-English speaking population, and today 4.5 billion people in the world are connected to the internet, but in the future the next billion will probably not be so comfortable speaking, writing, reading in English, and therefore the internet has to evolve along the way. And this evolution is also around about the very important kind of issue of breaking the digital divide. Now, Sarika ji gave the example of Baba Ka Dhaba. Let me give you a not so nice example, but it's important for us to consider. If you recall, go back to a few months ago, with the pandemic and the migrants, workers, our own countrymen and brothers and sisters trying to leave from wherever they were working and get information on how to get back home. Unfortunately, they were unable to use the internet to the fullest potential, because not enough content was available in the language they spoke. And this is where the need for a multilingual internet comes in. We take the internet and the content that we already have in English language for granted, but we really need to move beyond and be able to use the internet to its fullest potential. So, Ajayji has already mentioned some of the examples: signing on to an app with a local language email ID, being able to being able to access content in your local language. All of these things are part of breaking of the digital divide and creating a multilingual internet. And the email, and rightly pointed out by Ajayji, the email ID is one of the key, because it's like a trigger that lets you get into programs, that lets you fill out a form, that lets you, you know, access information. So we have a universal acceptance ambassador, Harish Chaudhary, today, and EAI expert, Mr. Lalchand Saini, who's going to be with you and guide you. I also realize, you know, this hour and a half or 90 minute webinar is possibly the beginning of a process for many of you. So please feel free to stay connected with us, with Fiki ILIA, you know, for follow up, to understand more, and to join the community which is promoting the multilingual internet. With those words, I hand it back to Sarika ji. Back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Gupta, for ending it, your opening address at such a positive note. Like we said, it's just a beginning, and this 1.5 hour session is just a beginning for all of you. So those who are not aware of EAI, to be aware of it, and then of course for others to work with us so that we can help you out in implementing EAI with your businesses as well. So thank you, Mr. Gupta, for sharing your opening remarks. Now we come to our next speaker. We have this next is the special remarks by Shri Anil Kumar Jani. He's the CEO of NICSI, Ministry of Electronics and Government of India. Vicky is happy to work in collaboration with NICSI, and we further want to take various initiatives together so that we can work in the area of changing the Indic internet, I would say, the landscape of India, as well as contributing in changing the people's life so that they can actually realize the potential to the fullest of the digital revolution. So we are very happy that we have joined hands with NICSI for the same. Over to you, Shri Jain. So we look forward to your thoughts. How do you see EAI contributing in this landscape and various Indic internet landscape, which is currently in the part of India? Over to you, Shri Jain. Jain, I think you're on mute.
Yeah. But camera is...
No, you're not... the camera is not visible.
Yeah. There is some error. So should I continue without camera, ma'am, in case your permission is there?
Sure, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Ajay Data, the co-chair of... ICT and Digital Economy Committee of FICCI, and also member of CCNSO Council of ICANN, head of ICANN in India, Mr. Samiran Gupta, Sarika ji, and other participants in this webinar. Good morning to all of you, and this is a very important webinar, which I personally feel, for promotion of broadband internet in this country, and not only in this country, I think in the world. But in this webinar, we will focus and restrict ourselves with India. So first of all, I am thankful to FICCI and ILIA to invite me in this particular webinar, and given this opportunity to talk to all of you. Friends, what I personally feel, that once a internet is there and it is helping reshaping the life of all of us, whether in office or in at home, and especially after COVID-19, which has given a acceleration, it has acted as a catalyst for promotion of internet and broadband. I think it is very, very important that the growth of internet and broadband should be inclusive. Inclusive means that we should be able to include each and every citizen of this country so that they can use internet and broadband effectively to make changes in their life. And if we are able to do that, believe me, there'll be a improvement in the GDP, upliftment in the social, political, and economical condition of this country. This is very, very important. Right now, around 70% of people, or more than 70% of the people who don't speak English, they are not effectively connected with internet. So we at NICSI, and I personally believe that we have to include them as part of it. As far as ICANN is concerned, NICSI is involved in various initiative of ICANN in developing IDN, especially in India. And I am very happy to inform all the audience that India is the only country which has 15 scripts and 23 languages where IDN is available. I think it is the only country which has more than one language and script which is working on internet as a domain. So for this, my really thankful to the entire team which was there under leadership of Dr. Govind, a team from NICSI, and big support by Dr. Ajay Datta, who is leading this particular initiative today at ICANN, and big support to Mr. Samiran Gupta. I think we have to take this work forward so that the efforts of all these people who have contributed in development of IDN in ICANN can reach to everybody in India. So basically now look, one is the development of all these IDNs and their integration of IDN in computer, universal acceptance of this in all the countries, so that whenever we are developing any website in local language or we are processing any email in local language, this should be well accepted word over, so that whenever we are sending any website or any email, that should be well covered by everybody. So this is one modifications or some work which is already there in developing the IDNs. But what NICSI is looking is not this. In fact, the work which the whole team is working, NICSI will continue to support. We will put more acceleration in the work. We will be having more representation in ICANN and all those things. But what we are looking at is that what are the different ways to take, to bring each and everybody on internet. So there are two group of people. One who are literate, but they are not literate in English. So they would like to promote in their own mother tongue. The second group of people is those who are illiterate. It means that they can speak in their mother tongue, but they can't write, they can't use computer, they can't use the keyboard. So I think we have to divide the whole efforts into two parts. One part which we are saying is the people who can read, write, and communicate in their local language. I think we have to prepare and we have to make more and more local contents which should be made available to those kind of people who can take advantage of the development of internet and content in the world. For that, universities should come forward, the government should come forward, the state government should come forward, and the local politicians and the social workers should come forward to promote more and more content, more and more websites, and development of emails in local language. So I think Dr. Ajay Datta and his entire group in his organization, they are totally dedicated in development of emails in local languages. And I really commend to their work and dedication to this particular cause for the country. And I wish that in whatever way Ajay Datta ji, NICSI can contribute in your efforts will be more than happy to do that. Similarly, Lixi would like to promote content development and content delivery in local languages. So we will be working on technologies and we will be working on marketing efforts to motivate people who can develop local contents and they start actually being used. I am really surprised because state governments, they work in their local language, and that is why all bureaucrats, they get trained first in the local language of the state in which they are allotted that seat, and they are trained to work in that area itself. But why the local language is not getting promoted in content development in internet, that is a dilemma even today to me. So Nixi would like to reach out to state governments, to all those people who are actually champions of local language, to do the content development and also help to build up the systems around internet to deliver that. There are certain issues which have been told that you know, keyboards are not available in local language. So BSNL is working along with CDAC to develop e-keyboards which can be sent to various people. They can invoke it, they can use it. Also, we are working on the hard keyboard also with the help of the manufacturer, so that these keyboards can be made available to those people who are eager to develop local contents, eager to deliver content, local contents. And these keyboards we would like to deliver at a very, very economical rate. The second group of people which I was talking is those who are illiterate. So we are in touch with CDAC now. They have a system to convert text into speech and speech into text, which is not yet promoted, which is not actually, you can say, refined to be used in each and every language. So we will be, Nixi will be working on these areas so that those people who are not yet in the internet community, who are illiterate, unfortunately, maybe because of any reason, they are not able to access to the education. We would like to make internet as access to them. So I am really happy that Fiki is doing a great job in that. Nixi is very happy to collaborate with Fiki in this particular field. And we would like to accelerate the work which ILIA is doing in this area, and we would like to collaborate in whatever way Fiki feel and they feel we are competent, we should be able to do that. As far as ICANN is concerned, they have developed a working group to resolve the current issues in IDA. Looking at the international feedback which the group has got, and I am very happy to be associated in that working group as vice chair, and I should be able to take care of various issues which are present today. For example, various variants which are available in various languages, and I think more work has to be done on the Indian languages. Then there are confusing similarities in various fonts and various scripts, and the system like the DNS should be able to recognize that and should be able to process all those things. And Indian languages are also combining various fonts together and preparing the composite fonts. So I, behalf of all of you as Indian internet community, is committing that I will spend huge amount of time in this. And during my tenure, all those issues which are reported to ICANN from various countries will be settled. And Nixi would like to be seen as one organization who is dedicated in promoting the local languages within the country and outside the country. And I am really thankful to Fiki, who has given me this opportunity to talk all people who are connected in this particular field. If you have any questions, you are most welcome to ask the questions right now, or if you want to send the questions, you can send the questions on my email. I'll be very, very happy to reply to all of that. Thank you, Sarika ji. Thank you, everybody, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a, I would say, the in-depth address on initiatives, what Vicky, Nixi has been taking in, and what are the intent Nixi wants to collaborate and contribute in this journey of the Indian Internet. We truly realize that India is the only country which has 23 ideas and 50 scripts. Of course, I am sure the members who have been listening this address are further motivated, because we all would like to work. There's a lot of work which comes in with this kind of diversity which India carries forward, so that we can actually then truly work on different areas to realize this potential. So we understand, we will be happy, I'm sure, with our members' support to collaborate with Nixi in this journey from every perspective, be it the IDNs or the software or the hardware. We'll be happy to work with you. Thank you, sir, for your encouraging words. For the audience, like sir mentioned, we are open for the questions. You can write in the chat and we will take up once we are over with the technical presentations, or even you can write to us and we will be happy to take it through or get you connected with the concerned panelist. So with this, we have come with the, we have heard the overview, the importance and all those areas. Now comes the technical part. We would like to let our audience know that how this EAI can be implemented, what are the things can be done, the specs of its configuration, which was broadly mentioned by Dr. Data. So for this, we have now the presentation on EAI configuration and technical overview by Mr. Anish Chaudhary, who is the UA ambassador and of course a big contributor in this area. So over to you, Mr. Chaudhary. We look forward to really take us through with this kind of details on EAI.
Thanks a lot, Sarika ji, and thanks a lot, Ajay Data ji and Mr. Samiran Gupta, as well as Sir Anil Kumar Jain, because they have really provided the important message on universal acceptance and its importance. Now I would share the technical information or some technical overview on the email address internationalization. So I hope my slides are visible to everybody.
Yes, Mr. Chaudhary, they are.
Okay.
Yeah, yes, it's okay now. Yeah, Mr. Chaudhary, we can see the slide.
First
slide is visible.
Okay, so on the first slide, I just want to highlight that you could have an email ID in Hindi like I have, and it's a working email ID, mail@internet.bharat. So this is one of the thing everybody can do, and how it could be done, I'll try to explain in the further slides. So please, next slide. So most important part of the, you know, email address internationalization is the fundamental aspects are Unicode, IDNs and universal acceptance. So basically, Unicode is encoding glyphs into code points. So there would be some technical terms. I would be explaining them and for the benefit of the audience. So there are some technical terms, and I would be explaining them during the course of the presentation. So what is Unicode? So Unicode is encoding glyphs into code points. So important question is, what is glyph? So specific, they are a specific shape, design or representation of a character. So and these characters could be, you know, encoded into the Unicode. For example, a code point have a multiple glyph. You can see there is a character like E, which is a Unicode character. It could be represented into two ways, U plus the hexadecimal format, and another representation of same code point, U plus 0065 and U plus 0300. So they are the encoding of used during the encoding process. So the important part is normalization. So we have to do normalization while encoding, while encoding the Unicode. So can people see the presentation, or should I move forward? Thanks. So basically, I was at the normalization. So normalization is the process to ensure that no matter the user type, the end representation will be the same. For example, user can type the character, Unicode character, which is looking similar to E, and they have two different code points, but normalization will give the final result as U plus 00E8. So normalization is very important part of the encoding. So basically, in specification, Unicode code points are shown in the hexadecimal using U plus XXXX notations, and code points are typically carried using the UTF-8, which is Unicode transformation format, 8-bit format. So why UTF-8 is very important? Because UTF-8 characters are basic encoding which is used in the implementation of email address internationalization. So we have two types of Unicode encoding, which is UTF-8 and UTF-16, but we use UTF-8, which is preferable. So UTF-8 character can be 1 to 4 byte long, and it is backward compatible with ASCII characters. So ASCII characters, we all know, the characters we are using in day-to-day basis on our internet and the computer systems. And UTF-8 is preferred encoding for email and web pages. So, and it is the gold standard for carrying Unicode code points on the internet. So you can see the importance of UTF-8 and why normalization is important in the implementation of email address internationalization. Next slide, please. Okay, now the second important fundamental concept is domain name. So a domain name is ordered set of labels A dot B dot C dot D. It is like, for example, you can say google.com or nixie.in. So the top level domain is the rightmost label D in the left to right scripts. And domain name system is distributed database, and it is useful and provide service for querying domain name and records. Under the domain names, we can have the DNS records. So these DNS records are, there could be variety of DNS records are there. For example, IPv4 addresses for the domain name, IPv6 addresses for the domain name. There could be host name of the email server responsible for that domain name. And we have the zone file, which has the list of domain name records called the resource records. So resource records could be, again, a very wide variety of resource record, and most common are MX resource record and CNAME type, A type, address type, or A type, that means A four times. So basically, these are the important resource records present in the zone file. Next slide, please. Thank you, Sudhir. So now we are at the internationalized domain names. So what are internationalized domain names? So international domain names, or IDNs, enable the use of non-ASCII characters for any label of a domain. So earlier we have domain names in English language only, but now we could have domain names in a form of internationalized domain names which represent local characters, local languages, or script. We have to understand that not all the labels of a domain name may be internationalized. For example, we have a internationalized domain name, example .ca, but the local part, you can see example with A with a certain character above it. So it is a Unicode or IDN domain name in which the TLD is not IDN. So it means not all the labels of a domain name may be internationalized. A user uses the IDN version, but the IDN is converted into the ASCII or DNS ASCII characters for the DNS resolution. So when a user uses the IDN domains, they are generally converted into the ASCII characters during the DNS resolution. So what are the, what is the process of conversion into ASCII for the DNS resolution? I have written the step by step process. So here you can see, if you type http example.ca, which is a IDN domain, or nixi.bharat, the browser first do the normalization process, and then browser convert the example.ca or nixi.bharat in a ASCII compatible representation called Punicode. This Punicode representation is defined by the RFC 3492, which is created at the Internet Engineering Task Force. So this representation converted into the Punicode, and during the conversion, the X and dash dash is added to the ASCII form of the Unicode conversion. So for example, the example.ca becomes xn dash dash example.xta.ca, or nixi.bharat becomes xn dash dash, and the entire coding, you can see that. Now browser calls the DNS to get the IP address of the converted Unicode, and in return browser connects to HTTP server at the received IP address. So this is the process of the DNS resolution of internationalized domain name. I know this is some kind of technical, but these are the fundamental things to understand the EAI deployment. Next slide, please. Okay, great. So the protocol for handling internationalized domain name are IDNA, that is the internationalized domain names in application. There are two versions of IDNA. It is IDNA 2003 and IDNA 2008. And important part is that while coding or implementing EAI, one should use IDNA 2008. We also have to understand the difference between ULABEL and ALABEL. So a ULABEL is the Unicode native representation of internationalized domain name. So this is, for example, nixi.bharat is ULABEL, and its ALABEL is the Punicode representation, which is xn dash dash and the encoded part of it, which would be used in the DNS resolution. Next slide, please. The universal acceptance. So in technical format, universal acceptance is about how to appropriately support internationalized identifiers as well as new and long TLDs. So the two important internationalized identifiers are internationalized domain names and email address internationalization. And and Dr. Ajay Data and all the esteemed speakers already discussed about the fundamentals of universal acceptance. So I am moving forward to the email technical topics as well as the email terminology for the EAI deployment. Next slide, please. So before moving forward, we have to understand how email is transferred from user to the recipient. And for that, we have to understand the email stack, which is composed of these important elements. So important elements are mail user agent, that is MUA. The mail user agent is the software used by user who sends and receive email. For example, with webmail, the MUA is an application run in a browser environment. So for example, Gmail or XGen running in browser. So it is the example of MUA. The Outlook, Thunderbird, they all are examples of mail user agent. Now the important mail transfer agent. So it is a server application that receives mail from mail submission agent or from another mail transfer agent. So it will find through the name servers and DNS the MX record from the recipient domain DNS zone in order to know how to transfer the mail. So MX records are very important. They are mail exchange records in DNS, which specifies which server is responsible for accepting email address on behalf of a domain. So that is the most one of the important part of MTA. The MTA finally transferred the mail using the simple mail transfer protocol to another MTA. And the examples of MTA are postfix, exim, sendmail, and qmail. So these are the basic building blocks we have to, first understand, and we have to understand its terminology and the use of different softwares. Now, the mail submission agent, and it is a server program that receives mail from the MUA and checks for any errors, then transfer it by using the simple mail transfer protocol to the mail transfer agent hosted on the same server. So we have to understand it is hosted on the same server. Typically, this function is bundled with an MTA. So we cannot, say that these four software are, four of them are independent and separate. They are bundled with each other. Now we have the mail delivery agent. So this software usually present on servers, which receives the email from the mail transferring agent and is the final destination of the email. It is typically stores the email in a file or a database and waits for the MUA of the destination user to fetch the email. Typically, this function is also bundled with mail transferring agent. Its example is Dovecot, which is mainly a POP3 and IMAP server and allowing MUA to retrieve mail, but also include an mail delivery agent, which takes mail from an MTA and deliver it to the server mailbox. So this is also very important. Next slide, please. So all the components I have described in earlier slide, you can see that how mail is transferred from sender to the receiver. I have put it in a diagram for the understanding of the users or the and the participants. You have to understand that the MTA, the postfix, is a software or a server which is MTA and typically used as MTA, MDA, and MSA. So it is working as all of it, like MTA, MDA, and MSA. So you can see that a sender is sending, an email through Gmail running in a browser, which is a mail user agent, by using the simple mail transferring protocol, and then it is submitted to the mail submission agent, and mail submission agent transferred the mail using simple mail transfer protocol to the MTA on the same server. Now that MTA is transferring mail to another MTA on a receiver's mail server, and then this MTA transferred the mail to the mail delivery agent using the simple mail transfer protocol. So you can see the important protocol here is simple mail transfer protocol. Now this mail delivery agent submitted the mail to the mailbox, and then these mails are retrieved using the IMAP and the POP protocols, and then delivered to the mail user agent of the receiver. It could be any mail user agent. Here it is Outlook. Next slide, please. So these are the some tips to find the destination server. So when you are sending an email using user@example.com, the method to find the destination email server could be querying the DNS for the MX record. So there are three MX records. And earlier, when an email is sent, the sender email server would try to connecting to either server 1 or server 2, and because they have the same priority. So why I have shown this example here, to just to show the priority, that the number 10, 10 and 20 are representing priorities. If none, you can see if none of the first two server respond, then the sender email server would try to connect to server 3 because it has lower priority. So the higher the number means lower priority. So the system admins can provide the priority to their email servers so that sender email server could easily connect. Next slide, please. Now we come to the email address internationalization part. The email syntax is very simple. Left side @ domain name. So domain name can be internationalized as internationalized domain names. They could be U labels or A label. So we have to understand that the domain name could be U label or A labels. Left side, also known as local part, it is Unicode UTF-8. So when the local part is Unicode UTF-8, it is EAI. So we have to understand that domain part could be U label or A label, but the left side, that which is local part or mailbox name, it should be UTF-8. Then it is known as EAI. It is as per the RFCs for the email address internationalization. So not all email servers support EAI. So this is the real issue. So a negotiation protocol is used to, send an EAI only when the target server supports it. So how to check if the target server supports it or not? So there is a negotiation protocol. If target server does not support, then the email will fall back and returns an unable to deliver message back to the sender. So that is why SMTP UTF-8, which is simple mail transfer protocol, Unicode transformation format 8 option, is used within the mail transfer protocol to signal the support of EAI by an email server. So if you want to check that the another server which is going to receive your email is EAI enabled or not, then you have to use SMTP UTF-8 option. So what is the overhead when you use SMTP UTF-8 option? The mail headers need to be updated to support EAI, and mail headers are very important because they are used by mail softwares to get more information on how to deliver email. So it is important that the server on both the sides should be SMTP UTF-8 enabled. Next slide, please. So what protocol changes we need to implement EAI? So SMTP is augmented to support EAI, and it has signaling flag SMTP UTF-8 to specify support of EAI. And all SMTP servers in the path must support EAI to successfully deliver the email. These are the very important tips to enable SMTP to support EAI. Now the another important protocol is POP or IMAP, and again it should be augmented to properly support EAI and have a signaling flag to specify support of EAI. In POP and IMAP case, they half support EAI by providing a downgraded email version to the non-EAI conforming email software clients. They downgrade, or downgrading mechanism is there. But the important tip is that the downgrading may cause many issues for the users and the system admins to debug issues. So it is advisable, try to avoid using the downgrading mechanism if you can, in case of POP and IMAP. So in case of EAI protocol, the SMTP server should announce the support of EAI, and SMTP client connecting to the compliant SMTP server. So we should show it by SMTP UTF-8 flag enabled. Headers of email should also show the support of UTF-8 content, and email body is already supporting UTF-8. UTF-8 means the Unicode characters or the characters in the local language. We have to also enable UTF-8 command. And how can we enable it? In the POP, we can enable through the UTF-8 command flag, and in IMAP, enable UTF-8 equal to accept command. So these are some tips how we can enable some changes in the EAI protocol to implement EAI. Next slide, please. So when everything is enabled, your email stack would look like this. Your sender, the mail client, the SMTP with EAI, mail server, then it is again SMTP with EAI, then we could have several mail servers in between, and then we have POP and IMAP with EAI. So finally, mail user client and the receiver would receive the email ID in the or the emails in the local language with the correct email ID. So the important tips here is the all email parties involved in the delivery path have to be updated for the EAI support. And if a single SMTP server in the path does not support EAI, then the email is not delivered. So we have to enable all the email servers in path to support EAI. Next slide, please. So we can demonstrate, and this is one of the setup which could be created. So we have MUA here, mail user agent is software, MailMate is used as a mail transferring agent, the courier software is used, and on another side the MTA is postfix is used, and another MTA servers are used, and finally we have mail user agent in the receiver side is Gmail. So email, we could have EI email path between two users. User one, we have an email is kevin@example.com. You can see this Kevin is not English, you know, they have some, they are with some Unicode characters in the local name as well as the domain name. So this setup is created by using MailMate on Mac OS X with SMTP UTF-8 enabled, and using his own mail server infrastructure. User two has peter@example.ca using Gmail web interface, no configuration necessary apart from the domain and user, and using Google mail server infrastructure. So this setup is created like this. Next slide, please. So for user Kevin, its inbound email server is courier as IMAP server, and its outbound email server is courier as SMTP server. Courier uses a postfix relay server acting as a pure MTA. And for user two, you can see that its inbound and outbound mail servers are Google Gmail servers. So when you confirm that advertised mail server postfix, then you can use dig command. So this is given DIG, and those who are proficient with Linux, they know the use of dig command. It will provide you the all the DNS records and other details. So finally, Kevin sent an email using the MUA MailMate, and it is delivered to MTA, which is courier is MTA software, and the postfix is also an MTA software, and then the mail is finally delivered to the Gmail. So that's the setup you can create using these slides, and you could have successfully delivered EAI email. Next slide, please. So how to configure? So this is the technical configuration file, and it is the configuration for the postfix server, which is used as mail transferring agent. So you can go to the slide /etc/postfix, and you can enable how to enable SMTP UTF-8. You have to enable the setting. You have to change the SMTP UTF-8 underscore enable to yes. So this is the settings you can do in the postfix. Next slide, please. Now the courier. So courier is again a MTA software, and you can change the file like this. You can to enable, you know, courier to support EAI. Next slide, please. And I have also used MailMate as a MUA agent. So this was the configuration which is done in MUA agent for the user kevin@example.com. You can see these are not ASCII domains. These are Unicode domains, because this E and A, E in Kevin and A in the example are Unicode characters. Using courier, in the SMTP and the IMAP server, how to do it and how to configure it, it is given in the diagram. And you have to set the default write com.freerun.mailmate.mmsftp.utf.enabled parameter to yes. Next slide, please. So finally, when all the setup is done and when you send the email, you can see the message sent from MailMate is reflected in the Gmail. So you can see how the email sent from the MailMate to Gmail would look like. So if the all the configuration are correct, then you would deliver a correct, internationalized email to the recipient. Next slide, please. So another important topics after this email address internationalization configuration that we have to give attention to the case folding. So in the normal usage or in the normal day-to-day email, when we use Kevin or Kevin in the small character or in the upper case or the lower case, they are generally considered same in ASCII characters. But in case of Unicode, they are not considered same. For example, Kevin and Kevin by default not the same user in case of Unicode. So we have to handle the Unicode case folding, seriously. Otherwise, when you send the email from Kevin in uppercase using the email ID with Kevin in uppercase, it will not be delivered to the correct because the Kevin in uppercase and Kevin in lowercase are different. So the basic difference between ASCII and the Unicode is that the ASCII email addresses, the local part can be uppercase or lowercase, and in UTF-8 case folding is not the same as ASCII. It is different. So we have to handle it carefully. The next slide, please. We also have to do the spam filtering very carefully. Spam filtering may think EAI is a spam, even with if you have implemented SPF, which is sender policy framework, or DKIM, which is domain key, and identified mail. So even then the spam filter consider EAI email as a spam. This is because the spam filtering does not know about EAI. So new top level domains and IDNs may also be viewed as a spam, and spam filtering may think EAI is a spam even with SPF DKIM. This is because the spam filtering not know about it, and we have to handle it carefully. And how we can handle it carefully? If we make sure that contact database contains the EAI email of the contacts. So this is the last line is very important. How to handle spam filtering? That you have to make sure during the implementation that the contacts database contains the EAI email of the contacts. The next slide, please. So there are some examples of mail software and services which supports EAI and which do not support EAI. So MailMate, Postfix, and Courier, they support EAI, and MailMate MUA on Mac OS X version 1.9.4 is minimum. For Postfix, the version 3.0 is minimum. And for Courier, for IMAP, POP, and SMTP, version 1.0 is minimum. Now, the IMAP version is 5.0.8 should be used. EAI not supported as of October 2019. Dovecot do not support IMAP and POP, Zimbra, and Mozilla Thunderbird. They do not support EAI. Services supporting EAI are Gmail and Outlook, as well as Exgen is also support EAI service in India, in addition to Gmail and Outlook. And the all other details are available in the document UASG021A, which is available at www.uasg.tech. So you may go to the website and you can have further details. Next slide, please. So the conclusion after all this, you know, technical jargons and, you know, details, the EAI is essentially supporting UTF-8 local parts of an email address. So you have to understand that local part should be UTF-8, which also means supporting in the headers, and it also requires changes to the mail servers and the mail clients along with the protocols. All SMTP servers in the path must be EAI enabled to deliver the mail to the destination. Courier and Postfix are two open source software that supports EAI with very limited changes in configuration. In configuration files, be careful to use A labels and U labels, or both, depending upon the situation. So there could be, you know, very different kind of situation arises when you have to handle A labels and U labels very carefully. Next slide, please. So this is the important resources you can utilize while implementing EAI. And recently, the USG published document USG 028, which is the consideration for naming internationalized email mailboxes. So this document is intended for email system administrators to help them provision mailbox, configure and manage system compatible with email address internationalization or internationalized email addresses. It outlines the consideration for naming internationalized mailbox and helps administrator to make good choices when setting their mailbox name policies. So this is very important document. You have to go through it while implementing EAI. Next slide. So this is one of the important, information from the recent UA readiness report provided by Universal Acceptance Steering Group, that only 9.7% of email servers are potentially configured to support email addresses in local languages and script. So I hope that in India, we will configure more and more servers to, so that they would be EAI enabled. And And only 11% of the top 1,000 websites globally support email addresses in Arabic and Chinese. And the good part is that 98.3% of top 1,000 websites globally support email addresses with short top level domain. Short top level domains are basically CCTLDs, let's say .in, .fr. So, but we have to look at the, figure of 9.7%. And I hope that after configuring these email servers and EAI servers, we will have, we will increase this percentage soon. Next slide, please. And thank you. Thank you all for listening for my presentation. If you have questions, you can ask in the question and answer session. Thank you.
Thank you, Harishji, for sharing this overview on this technical thing. Like you ended up that with this only 11% of the top 1,000 global websites which just accept in Chinese and Arabic. So we understand that in India, of course, a lot needs to be done, and we have the commitments of organizations like Fiki ILI and others to work with all of you. So thank you all for the viewers. We really apologize for the technical error which happened in between. So for which you have to face some inconvenience due to not visibility of the slides. We are very sorry for that. In case, I'm sure we'll check with the speakers, and if they're comfortable, we'll be happy to share the copy of the presentations with you. Also, like we mentioned, we are open for the questions from your side whenever you feel like, so that right now or later on, so that we can help you in our best possible way. So we understand there are a few things which is out of the hand. Something happened in the software, so it's okay. But we have been able to sort it out. So thank you. And I think rest everything is running smoothly. So with this, I come to the next speaker after this technical overview and how it needs to be done and everything by Mr. Harish Chaudhary. We have another speaker, Mr. Lalchand Saini, who is a EAI expert. And he's, of course, talking about how EAI they have implemented in their organization. What are the benefits they have achieved out of it, and how this really has helped the organization to grow. So you will talk about the real-time implementation part. Over to you, Mr. Saini.
Thank you, Charibadi. First of all, I would like to thank you, Mr. Ajay Data, sir, for giving this opportunity, and everyone else. Thank Harish for that wonderful presentation.
यू सनी जी.
I have shared my screen. Could everyone see that?
Yes, send it visible.
Okay. Today we are talking about email address internationalization and how it works in applications. When talking about email address internationalization, there are different categories of EI, as you can see in this slide. First category is ASCII@ASCII. In that, local part is in ASCII and domain name is also in ASCII. For example, we can say lal@apka.account, and the other category is ASCII@IDN. For example, mark@data.bharat. Mark is in ASCII characters, and data.bharat is in IDN. The next category is Unicode@ASCII. For example, Ajay@example.com. Ajay is in Unicode and the domain name is in ASCII. The next category is Unicode@IDN. For example, sampark@datamail.bharat. So in that email ID, sampark is in Unicode and datamail.bharat is an IDN domain. Next category is Unicode@IDN, and you can see there's an email address in Urdu, which is a right to left script. In that, local part is Unicode and domain name is in IDN. And there are different stages for UA readiness in every application. Web application, Android application, iOS application, stages are same. The first stage is accept. So for EI, first of all, every application should be able to accept EI email address. Email address could be in any language, and application should be able to accept that. Then the second stage is validate. If somebody entered EI email address, application should be validated that email address is correct or not, and it should display proper error if email address is not correct. Now the third stage is process. So after taking input from user, applications sometimes needs to process that input, and application should be able to process if data or we can say email address is internationalized. Then the next stage is store. Application should be able to store EI email address in application if it requires. The next stage is display. After receiving an email, we need to also display that or in application. So let's look at this example. This is an example from Action Plus app, which is available on Play Store, and you can also use DataMail app, which is easily available on Play Store to experience EI. You can create an email account on that and experience. So in this example, if a user is entering any email address, any EI enabled email address, so what we will do, we will try to log in that account on application, and what are the stages and what are the things which we need to take care, let's see in next slide. So there are two input fields, one for email address and one for password. So if there is any input field should be able to accept any IDN email address. First thing is that, and the second thing, email address entered by user should be validated for universal acceptance. So sometime when I tried to type any email address in lots of applications, it doesn't accept. I'm trying to type lalchandra@datamail.bharat and it doesn't accept. So first thing, it should accept. Second thing, if I entered a wrong or invalid EI email address, it should show some error. Third, process email address entered by user for validating on SMTP and IMAP. Hariji already explained that what is SMTP and what is IMAP. SMTP is basically simple mail transfer protocol to send mails, and IMAP is Internet Message Access Protocol to receive emails. So if you need to process email address, IDN email address, then you have to take care of that also. Next, store email account in application. So what we are doing in Exim Plus app, after configuring that account, we also stores that in application. Next is display email received from any email account. So I have configured my account lalchandra@datamail.bharat and I'm trying to send email. Somebody send me email from his account, his IDN account. So we should be able to display that email. For to achieve this, to validate IDN email addresses, we have created a small library which is available on GitHub. You can see there is a link of GitHub. This is a small utility which works with Java applications and Android applications. Everybody can download it, modify it, and use it. And to convert internationalized domain names between normal Unicode representation and ASCII compatible encoding, we are using Java class, which is IDN class, which converts IDN to ASCII and ASCII to IDN. And there is a one thing that all the input fields, here is a note, all the input fields should be able to accept UTF-8 characters. If you are not accepting UTF-8 character, then you cannot achieve this thing. And thank you very much, everyone. I sincerely appreciate your attention. If you have any query, please proceed. And you can also reach me at lalchand.saini@bharatsinghcom and lalchand@datamail.bharat. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Mr. Saini, for sharing your experience and the things which you have done at your end. With this, we have come to an end of the technical overview and its implementation part. I would now open the floor for the questions. There are a couple of questions which already the audience has put it forward. So I would read out those questions and I would request the panelists to kindly take it from here. Also, if there's any other questions which the audience wants to ask, they are free to write back in the chat box if my colleagues will help them with the same. So one of the questions which has come over is that how UA and EAI implementation can help our organizations grow global while being local in a post-COVID-19 world. So maybe I would request Dr. Data, if you would like to share your thoughts on the same.
Yeah, I think I can answer that. This is very simple in a way, because as we have rightly said in the beginning, that this is all about bringing next billion people. So it is local and global. The people who do not speak in English or would not like to prefer communication in an English language, obviously would like to have a preference in a language of their choice. So let us take an example of Russia, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, China, Korea, Thailand, Japan, you name the country. And these countries do not prefer English as a primary language. They have their own language as a primary. So let us assume that if the language people start adopting EAI as their primary communication, and if you want to deal with them, how do you communicate? How do you send an invoice? How do you send a transaction to them? You have to prepare your infrastructure to receive even an inquiry on your website and receive an email. So it is very, very fundamental for futuristic to go on that site.
Sure. Thank you, Dr. Gita, for sharing with us. Anybody else wants to add out anything? Mr. Chaudhary, anybody else wants to say something here? Mr. Gupta, Mr. Chaudhary, do you want to add on anything to this question?
Yes. Hi, this is Samiran Gupta. I just wanted to add to what Dr. Data just said. So he gave an excellent example of how, in fact, having this facility helps you with your business when you're doing business with countries which do not use English as the language. But, you know, I would also want us to introspect and say that COVID or not, all right, UAE and IDNs are very important for us to be a better local, you know, because we still need, you know, there's so much of our own society who need to be connected and available online, which you know, actually Mr. Anil Jain spoke about. And we need to keep that in mind as well. So, yes, reaching outwards is also there. Reaching inwards and doing that even better is also an opportunity. Thank you,
Mr. Gupta. There's another question from the audience which has said that where can we get the more detailed technical information about EAI implementation? And also, how from a person who is really new in this area can start this process of EAI implementation? So, Mr. Chaudhary or anybody else who would like to take up, Mr. Saini, you would like to say anything on this? Am I audible?
You are audible, and let me answer this. Very simple. So I would request you to go on a website called uasg.tech. Sarikaji, if you can type in the chat for the audience, or you can just for at least the panelist, and I'm just going to repeat for the audience who are listening on streams on YouTube, uasg.tech. This is the website of the group. There is enough content available for IT leaders, for developers, and for generally people are interested in. And this section of the information section on that website takes you through the technical documents. And there is a specific document where there is a evaluation document, and there is a evaluation of major software developers and readiness of TLDs. Especially you will see them there. And there is a blueprint from CIOs. All those things are available to you. Now there is going to be a ready document. I am not sure it is published or not, but soon it should be, or if it is not yet till now. How do we make systems EAI ready? That document is going to be there. Sarikaji, we will, I hope that we have the audience, we will be able to send out that document also in the future. But by that time, you should be able to find that document available there on their site under the information section on uasg.tech. You will find certainly many things which could help you to build EAI in your applications.
Thank you,
One more thing. There is a document called UASG 14, UASG 14. That will tell you, that give you a quick guide on EAI. So if you want to immediately have a knowledge on how EAI works and how that system works, is very good. Another document which we have published 2 days before, That is consideration for naming internationalized email boxes. So that's a very important thing and a very important subject, just to tell you that this document is available on site. 2 days before only we approved it to be published. That document is there. That document tells you how do you standardize and put a mailbox name in an EAI as a subject, as EAI as a concept. Just like you cannot use percentage sign or a hash sign in an ASCII format in your mailbox name, right? We can't use them. It's not allowed. You can't use a percentage sign and a hash sign in your mailbox name. Just like that, there has to be rule in EAI where IDNs and Unicodes are being used. What kind of rules will be followed? So that recommendation has been done by the group, which is UASG 028 document. UASG 028. If you Google it, you'll find that document. And that document is very, very useful for the people who are interested in EAI. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Data. So I think for the audience, I think you have to go to uasg.tech and definitely refer to the documents which mentioned by Dr. Data, specifically focusing on number 14 and 28. Mr. Gupta, you would like to add something here?
Yes, indeed. These are very good questions. And I believe that, you know, as I said right in the beginning, that, you know, this is just 90 minutes or maybe a little more than 90 minutes. I would encourage participants who have more questions to be in touch with the local initiative, Sarikaji, your team. And, you can work with USG.tech or the local ambassadors. Perhaps the other ambassadors are also online today, apart from Mr. Chaudhary, and who can guide, users who would like to deploy EAI. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gupta. Like he mentioned, as mentioned by Dr. Data, we there is a set of documents which we'll request you to refer. And of course, as the resources to help in, we have the FICCI IRA Secretariat along with the support of the UAE ambassadors, Mr. Chaudhary and others. We have the three UAE ambassadors from India who are there, Mr. Aman Mazid and Mr. Srinath Sena. So we all will be happy to help you out with this process. So please write back to us. We'll be happy to help you in the process and definitely visit the website uasg.tech to have further knowledge about the subject and to look into the various rules and regulations required for its implementation. So thank you. With this, we come to the end of this technical webinar. Thank you, audience, for joining us for this. I am assuming that the content we shared in this webinar is useful for you. And if they have any feedback, any questions for us, please write back to us. Thank you, all the panelists, for sharing time with us and, of course, speaking on such an important subject, which is, of course, very important for everybody and especially for a country like India. We are, when we are talking about 23 IDNs, which are the CEO Nixi, Mr. Jain, mentioned. So with this, I would like to thank Shri Anil Kumar Jainji, the CEO of Nixi and METI, Government of India, Mr. Samiran Gupta, Head of India ICANN, Dr. Ajay Data, Co-Chair, ICT and Digital Economy Committee and Chairman, UASG ICANN, and our EU Ambassador, Mr. Harish Chaudhary, and our EAI expert, Mr. Lal Chand Saini. Thank you all for joining us today. We will be back with another second series on the technical webinar, as well as the other, I would say, the consultations, which we do it on the area of UA, which is not only technical, but other, I would say, which is more about generic in nature as well. So we'll come back to you. We'll keep on posting the details. You have any queries? My colleague has already posted that email ID in the chat, which is ficky.ict@ficky.com. Please write back to us and we'll be happy to help you out. So thank you all. Thank you for joining us. Stay safe and we will meet again soon.
Thank you very much, Harikari. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.